This week on Lights, Camera, Vegas. Brad Pitt boards the bullet train. Harry Styles takes us on a ride with a sexy new thriller. And Elvis dances onto the big screen. We've got a look at the biggest movies hitting theaters in the coming months as your favorite stars roll out big films right here in Vegas. Then, speaking of blockbusters, Top Gun Maverick is about to go supersonic on the silver screen, and we're talking to Jennifer Connelly about joining the iconic franchise and her first ever encounter with Tom Cruise.
No, I had never crossed paths with him before.
What?
I had never met him before.
See how Jennifer describes the experience and what fears she conquered while making the movie. Plus, you've likely seen the title Russian Doll on your Netflix queue, but what is this time-bending travel adventure all about? We're getting scoop straight from the cast.
It just takes it to a whole new level.
Then Bling Empire is back for a second season, and the cast tells us about a cool new Vegas connection. It all starts now on Lights, Camera, Vegas.
Lights, Camera, Vegas. Right now we're outside of Caesars Coliseum, which is usually home to superstar headliners like Keith Urban and Sting. But right now it's also home to the biggest movie event of the year, CinemaCon. And you know, whether it's movies or music, when it comes to entertainment, we've always got you covered.
Is ready to swing that hammer again. Family favorites like Buzz Lightyear and the Minions are back.
Teach a new kung fu for smoochie smoochie.
And beloved best-selling books are hitting the big screen.
Life persists. Way out yonder where the crawdads sing.
Yes, it's going to be a Jurassic year at the movies. Huge blockbusters will be roaring into theaters, but some exciting new dramas are also ready to thrill us.
What if this place is dangerous? What if
we're... No. Jack, it's okay. I'm curious to hear where she's going with this.
Don't Worry, Darling is Olivia Wilde's second film as director. She also stars alongside Florence Pugh, Harry Styles, and Chris Pine in this psychological film set in the 60s.
It is time to stop speaking.
Instead of going back in time, famed filmmaker David Cronenberg is looking ahead in his newest Crimes of the Future and actually made his first ever trip to Vegas to debut footage at CinemaCon.
We are so happy to welcome you to Vegas. And is this correct? I understand in the presentation, you said this is your first time to our city?
Yes, it is. I'm ashamed to say, because of course Vegas lives in movies and in the imagination and has done all my life actually. Aside from presenting the movie, it's exciting.
And also you said too, showing the first footage, which is so exciting to see a film from you after, people have been waiting for your next film. And you said Caesar's Palace was like the perfect place to show this video and unleash your attack on the world, right?
Yes, that's right. I said, yes, Vegas is a launch pad. It's a great launch pad for Crimes of the Future. Perfect, actually.
Another film getting a lot of buzz and showcasing at CinemaCon is Elvis.
Was my destiny.
I wish to promote you, Mr. Presley.
Baz Luhrmann, who's given us films like Moulin Rouge and The Great Gatsby, says he's excited to celebrate the king in this new film. And of course, Vegas has a starring role in the story. Jordan Peele also hit Vegas to debut first footage of his next adventure, Nope, and everyone was saying yes to big laughs in the new comedy, Easter Sunday.
Joe? Vanessa.
Yeah, Joe Valencia.
And this your dad?
You know, me and him used to be real intimate back in the day.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I could have been your mama, but clearly I'm not.
Yeah.
Diane Keaton told us she's ready for a laugh with her body-swapping comedy, Mac and Rita.
We'll ruin your life the way you ruin mine.
Dude, I don't even know you.
Get ready to see Bad Bunny and Brad Pitt battle on the bullet train and then take a trip across the pond in Downton Abbey, A New Era. And a new era at theaters is emerging as people are ready to gather once again with friends and see movies on the silver screen and truly celebrate the excitement of cinema.
Those are your pilots. Anything happens to them. You'll never forgive yourself.
No turning back now.
And look at you, you're ready with your t-shirt, with your playing hair.
Well, we got to see the very first screening in Caesar's Palace at CinemaCon, so.
Oh, wow.
Right? Have you seen it with a big audience like that
yet?
No,
I saw it alone with my family, but that was also incredibly exciting. I got to see it on a big screen that Tom very graciously set up for us, and my kids were on the edge of their seats the whole time. My daughter was literally, her knees were bouncing the whole time. She was so excited.
Jeez. Having any fun yet?
I've been a fan of yours since Labyrinth, back in the day.
Oh, thank you.
Another iconic film, which also growing up with Top Gun, Labyrinth, to see you in this movie now, 30 years later, to me just feels like this full circle, perfect casting moment. I think you were just a perfect choice. So I love seeing you part of this family.
Thank you. Thank you. I was really flattered that they thought of me and so excited to be part of it. And also, speak of full circle moments, I mean, I feel like it was great. It's really, you know, Penny Benjamin, my character, is mentioned in the original film. So I think it's really fun that this is, you know, that they meet again. And you feel like they've met several times over the years and that they come together now at this point in their lives in this film.
Captain Pete Maverick Mitchell. Let me be perfectly blunt. You are not my first choice. You are here at the request of Admiral Kazansky, AKA Iceman. He seems to think that you have something left to offer the Navy. What that is, I can't imagine.
This movie, the expectations have been high, but to see the film and it more than exceeds on excitement, action, but also so heartfelt.
It was wonderful. He brings all of himself in every moment. You know, there's so much passion for making movies, so much love, so much respect for his fans and audiences. And you know, working with him and doing scenes with him was just an honor and privilege. You couldn't ask for more working with someone like that. I mean, it's pretty extraordinary.
Well, because you guys have both been in the industry for so long, and I'm sure cross paths and work together, but when you get into
No, I had never crossed paths with him before.
What?
I had never met him before.
How is that possible?
I had never met him. I met him when, you know, I'd worked with Joe Kaczynski, the director, before, and he approached me about this, and he's like, I can show you the script. I was like, yes, but okay, I'm in. And I went and I met Tom, and you know, that in itself was really exciting for me.
Yeah.
It was just the beginning of it. I was like, wow, you're Tom Cruise. I had never met him before.
That's crazy after all the years and movies you both have done and everything. So it just, you know what? It was worth the wait, right?
Thanks. I think it was worth the wait. Yeah.
Understand too, you know, he's a daredevil, does all these stunts. You yourself, though, not a fan of flying before this film, right?
I know. Gratefully, I had worked through that because I thought, this is really starting to get in my way. I have to take this on. And I had gotten to a good place with it. But that was really tested on this film with the, you know, addition of the flying sequence that I had at the end of it, which Tom piloted. But I have to say, I can't imagine having more confidence in a pilot. People have asked me, was that terrifying? And I don't think I could have trusted my pilot anymore.
Wow.
He is so skilled at pretty much everything that I saw him do. So there's that.
Well, so are you. And honestly, you bring so much to the film, and it was just great seeing you in this role. And I just think that this is the movie we need to get people back to theaters and just kick off this summer blockbuster that we all love so much.
I think so too.
What is this, some kind of like 80s flesh mask?
The universe finally found something worse than death. I broke time.
Do I need to be worried?
I mean, this is the multiverse that has much more action-packed. We don't need suits. We don't have to sling webs. I mean, how do you keep coming up with these creative concepts, girl?
I don't know. You know, I was born inside a spider and inside a time machine. Listen, I don't know. I'm grateful, and I will say we do work hard on it. I read a lot of books, and I'm a curious person, and I just really want to do my best to sort of tell the truth, I guess.
You're a time traveler.
I prefer the term time prisoner. Where are we? More like, when are we?
Out of.
Never mind.
Congratulations on season two.
Thank you. We're so excited. Woo!
It's such a cool show. Like, you know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of time travel things, wormholes. Like, sometimes those things are done in a really cliched way, but to come in at like all these different directions and be and kind of make the genre completely fresh and creative has got to be so exciting as an actor.
Yeah, I mean, the thing that I love about this is there's a humanity to it that supersedes the kind of, you know, cool things that we could do with them. Jumping time and seeing different times in history, and you know, and all the clothes, and all the things that we do also love.
Maybe we have unfinished business. So you're telling me that this family lost its gold twice on a train?
Nadia, don't mess this up. Maybe we're just supposed to like enjoy the ride.
I'm still exploring my options.
There are things in life that cannot be explained.
Inexplicable things happening is my entire modus operandi.
If you could time travel to any era in Vegas history, what time period would you pick?
Wow. Wait, how old is Vegas?
Vegas, you gotta figure, you got, right? You got Bugsy,
yep.
Right? That's big, yep. Vegas energy. Interesting. But that's I don't know if that's like the best time to be a woman. you know what I mean? I'm aging into a futurist, so I'd be very curious to see the Vegas of the future in a way. Well, yeah, I guess if I had to vote, I don't know, 2057?
Ooh, I love it. Cher is still performing and so is Celine, right?
That's right. It's like Futurama.
And I cannot leave you yet as a TV anchor, obsessed with, of course, the morning show.
Don't forget, this is your show.
And we're back.
Two.
I know I come with a history that not all of you love.
One. 9 months ago, you opened a door, and you need to walk through it now.
Anything you can tell us about season three, just so fans have a little nugget?
No, I can't say anything. Is that for an answer?
That's it?
Can't say anything. They're writing it. They're writing it, and it's happening. There's another season, and that's all I can say.
And like Russian Dolls, it'll be worth the wait, right?
Yeah.
Chloe's laughing. Yo.
Still ahead, how the heck did Xavier Mortimer do that? We'll chat with the Vegas magician coming up. But first, the bling is back.
Knock, knock.
Bling Empire makes a dramatic season two return, and we talk to the cast.
What's up, everybody? You are watching Lights, Camera, Vegas with the world-renowned Rachel Smith. Back to you.
It's spectacular.
This one, it just takes it to a whole new level.
Las Vegas. I had the chance to talk with Kevin last year. We've been waiting for season two, so we manifested it, Kevin. It happened. Congratulations, you guys.
Thanks, Rachel.
What's up, Vegas?
Right? I know. First of all, too, Kim, Vegas, yeah. I love seeing the spotlight with
Thank
your
you. You
know, wind residency. Are you having so much fun as a DJ there?
Oh my God. First of all, I love Vegas, and being at the Wynn, it's been so much fun. Vegas is my second home. You're like my neighbor now.
Well, let's go hang, okay? I mean, they still let me in the clubs, I think.
Just walking with Kim. You're good.
Oh my gosh, that would up my cool factor so high. And Kim, besides, you know, DJing at the Wynn, which you have you're in such amazing company with Diplo and Chainsmokers. I love to see you guys give us, first of all, amazing representation with the show, but in the world of music and DJing specifically, having female representation is huge. So you're giving us all that on every front. I love it.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, having a Wynn residency isn't about just DJing and you know, having fun. Basically one of the females at the Wynn, and I'm bringing such a massive audience of women there. You know, girls can come to my show, have fun, let loose, have a great time. And that's what makes me happy in the day.
I am single, finally.
I'm going to just tell him how I feel.
The problem with getting involved with Kevin is I'm gonna have to get over the fact that he dated all these girls.
I know you guys haven't seen all the episodes, but honestly, season two, it's so fun because we've all met you now. We have a little background, and it's interesting to see where these relationships go.
I hate it when people lie to me.
Hey! No, I had to tell her.
You had to tell her.
I hate when you do this.
Oh my God, I am in complete shock.
And Kate, I mean, honestly, you have just so much fun, energy, fashion. I mean, you bring a lot of, people say, you say you're not gossipy, but you know, you gotta have somebody who stirs the pot a little, right? Or be a boring show.
Well, I wouldn't credit a certain part. I'm just in the middle of a lot of friendships, and it's tough because, you know, I adore Kim, I adore Kevin, and I'm in the middle. I wanna protect them both, and I'm stuck in this situation. I mean, there won't be a show without any gossip, right? At least I think if you watched it, at least hopefully I brought the humor, and that's more important for me.
Absolutely, you did. And if he brought the humor, you know, Kevin, you brought a lot of the heart. You were very vulnerable and opening up about your, you know, true feelings and wanting to be serious. And a lot of guys can't do that very easily on camera or in real life.
I think I'm a hopeless romantic by nature. I mean, I remember when I was like 8 years old and I wanted a girlfriend right away. And my mom was scared because she's like, you're only 8 years old, you want a girlfriend? I was like, yeah, man, like that's what I want in life. We will continue to wait to see what happens in season two about the romance in my life. Knock,
knock. I'm Dorothy Wang.
Dorothy's father is also a billionaire.
People like Dorothy, all they do is gossip and create drama.
Kane has been trying to get lunch since 2011, and I'd rather fast for 87 days straight.
Dorothy, welcome back to reality TV. I think I watched you, was it like 8 years ago on The Rich Kids of Beverly Hills, was it called?
I think it was like 6 years ago, maybe. Yes, it's called Riches of Beverly Hills, yes.
Yes, so what is it like coming back for a second round at it?
I mean, it honestly feels like it's like riding a bicycle. I just hop right back on.
It was similar in the sense that a lot of people in that show were very affluent, obviously, but this time there's representation with a cast we don't always see on TV. How special and important was that to you? And you were probably excited to see the first season come out even, right?
Yeah, it was important for me, and it was actually very nice, and it felt, even though I know that I have some issues with some people on this cast, it was nice to be able to do something with an all-Asian cast, and even if I don't get along with everyone, at least it is good for our community, and it is good for visibility, and it is even just nice to be able to connect with more Asians and to tell Asian stories, which I wasn't able to do with, you know, my first group of friends on that show.
Money so unimpresses me. It impresses you. It impresses
me. It actually doesn't impress me.
It is so obvious what everybody else sees.
Oh, I'm so sorry I come off that way.
I swear only with this girl.
I hope this is just the beginning. And, you know, there has been, like, you know, a good, I feel like, after came out this recently, especially like Netflix has with Squid Games, we've seen a lot more Asian roles and just shows in general. And so it's like such a great thing.
A basic thing is that in life, everybody has to learn from each other. Everybody Absolutely. Has something to give to somebody. So it doesn't matter, black, white, yellow, pink, Asian, whatever. I just hope that it's not a trend and that it keeps going.
When you can entertain, inspire, and even educate, that's a winning show. So you guys, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Next, he amazes crowds at his show in Vegas, and Xavier Mortimer even did a special magic trick for Rachel.
Jacob, I told you I forgot my tie today, so it makes up for it, right?
Vegas headliner is soaring in popularity, literally. Magician Xavier Mortimer recently went viral for this incredible stunt, basically riding on a taxi cab with one arm down the entire Vegas Strip.
I mean, yeah. I watched that so many times from so many angles. I mean, just between friends, how did you do that?
Well, a magician doesn't reveal his secrets.
I mean, how did you dream up that stunt?
Dream is a good word because nothing is impossible. And we make it come true.
The former Cirque performer is dazzling audiences with his show, The Dreammaker at the Strat. And he's truly taking magic to new heights with his unique approach. He even did a trick for me right in the middle of our interview.
Jacob, I'm pretty red. I told you I forgot my tie today, so it makes up for it, right?
Okay.
Oh, hold on. No. It's going to look better like this. How does it look?
I think it looks great.
Yeah, if you're up 20 times, 1, 2, 3, get a real one.
What? That is amazing.
What's also amazing is Xavier's social media presence, which has blown up this past year. He now has more than 10 million followers and over 100 million views on TikTok, thanks in part to viral videos with his famous friends like Jason Derulo.
I get the drinks too,
right? Mm-hmm. So well.
You have so much celebrity support. I mean, you're best buddies with Jason Derulo. Your stunts together are, you know, he's like, I'm a musician, but he probably thinks he's a part-time magician now because of you, right?
Yes. Yeah, it was a really fun collaboration. I hope I can do more. I'm going to try to go back to Los Angeles and do more stuff like this, like TikToks. It's really fun. I love it.
Whether it's on social media or at his show at the Strat, Xavier is always working to step up his game, especially once he arrived in the most magical city of all.
And you probably have to push yourself even more once you got to Las Vegas, knowing that this is the not only the entertainment capital of the world, but the magic community of all time. I mean, you've got everyone from Penn and Teller to Chris Angel, David Copperfield. I mean, so many great illusionists. So you got to make sure your game's always stepping up, right?
Yeah, actually, when I first came here, I was with Cirque du Soleil, and I had my little tricks in my suitcase, and I was like, no, I can't show a trick here. I mean, there's so many great magicians. Why would I show something? And the more you go, the more you learn, and you adapt, and you grow, and you work. And you finally make something that is relevant, and you discover that, yeah, you've achieved something, and that's the best reward.
And reward yourself to great entertainment by checking out Xavier's Vegas residency, which will have you wondering for days, just how did he do that?
I can't wait to see Jordan Peele's Nope when it hits theaters on July 22nd. When you're talking entertainment, though, at Lights, Camera, Vegas, we always say, yep. Thanks for being with us. I cracked myself up. For Lights, Camera, Vegas, until next time, guys, take care.